Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And welcome to this service of witness to the resurrection as we give thanks to God for the life of Robert Y. Kopf, Jr. As we gather in worship today, I want to introduce myself. My name is Derek Davenport. It is my honor and privilege to serve as one of the pastors here, alongside Mike Kramer, another of our pastors who will be leading the service along with me today. As we gather for this service, chances are at some point you have been at a service like this where someone's phone has gone off. Don't let it be yours. This is your opportunity to take your phone off and make sure it is turned off for our service this morning. And I want to make sure I let you know that the family would like to invite you to join them for a reception immediately following the service. And you can find the address at the bottom of your bulletin. So immediately after the end of the bulletin on the right-hand page, you'll find the address. And the family would love to have you join them for a reception after the service. I will remind you of that as we get closer to that time. But at this point, as we gather for worship, I invite you now to hear these words from Scripture. From the Psalms, "Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth." In Paul's letter to the church in Rome, he writes, "When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with Christ in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his." John's gospel proclaims, "I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." The psalmist writes, "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear." And these words from Paul, "I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." Let us pray. Eternal God, we bless you for the great company of all those who have kept the faith, those who have finished their race, and who now rest from their labor. We praise you for those dear to us, whom we name now silently in our hearts before you. Especially on this day, we thank you for Bob, whom you have now received into your presence. Help us to believe where we have not seen, trusting you to lead us through our years. Bring us at last, with all your saints, into the joy of your home, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As we gather, we will hear now from several members of Bob's family. And so I invite first Bob's grandson, R.Y., to come forward to the microphone. And I'll mention this to each of you, just do watch your step on the green platform.
Thank you, everybody, for gathering here today. It's nice to see all of you. Well, I'm going to get right to the point. Granddad hated long-winded speakers more than a lot of other things in life, so let me be direct. Just a few days before he passed, I had a chance to sit down with my grandfather, and while we spoke, he mentioned several theological questions that had been really on his mind over the last few weeks of his life. And throughout his life, I knew my grandfather as a man of practicalities, of very concrete sensibilities. He was very concerned with ethics, with right and wrong, with our duty to our neighbors. He was a lawyer, after all. So when Granddad began to ask these more esoteric questions about the nature of life, about heaven and hell, and about God, it was a little unexpected for me. But as a pastor, I get these questions a lot. However, they resonate differently when a loved one, when a family member who is near the end of their time on earth begins to ask them. And during our conversation, one point we kept returning to was the matter of Bob's wife, Susie, my grandmother. Granddad missed her terribly. and his lingering heartbreak was abundantly evident. We discussed why good people are so often taken from us in an untimely or tragic way, and how platitudes like "it was their time" never do justice to the grief that we feel over their passing. I shared with him that ultimately we cannot know with certainty the reason for timing of someone's passing. That is God's domain alone. But I also reassured him that God welcomes each of us who approach him in faith and repentance. And with that in mind, I told Granddad that I trusted and had faith that Susie was waiting for him, even as we spoke. It is with that same faith that I can share with you today the joy I feel, even amid my grief, that my grandmother and my grandfather are celebrating their reunion even now. I shared a verse with Granddad during our talk, and I would like to share that verse with you all now. It's from the book of Isaiah, chapter 52, verses 1 and 2. The righteous perish, and no one takes it to heart. The devout are taken away, and no one understands. That the righteous are taken away to be spared from evil. Those who walk uprightly enter into peace, and they find rest as they lie in death. And now there is one more thing I would like to leave you with today, and that is a particularly fond memory I have of my grandfather. In fact, this memory stands more brightly in my mind than any of the others I have of him. When I was younger, I looked forward to each year where we would take an annual grandfather, father, son fishing trip to a place called Lake Stramond in Canada. There was something actually pretty magical about driving for hours into the wilderness north of any major habitation of mankind to find this lake out in the middle of nowhere, stay at a lodge with family and with friends, and be able to celebrate just spending time together. Fishing was wonderful. Yes, that was a lot of fun, but it was the time spent that I think we all remembered most fondly. The moment that stands out in particular to me is not anything particularly grand or revelatory or anything of the sort. It was actually very simple. My granddad and I were sitting in a boat one afternoon on a very hot day in a place called Ottawa Bay. And I remember it as a terrible day of fishing. We had been out there all afternoon, all since lunch, for hours in truly hot sun. Not even a bite came to us, not even a nibble. We tried spot after spot, changing lures again and again, and nothing doing. We couldn't get it to work. And on that day, I began to cry. My granddad thought I was upset because we hadn't caught anything, and he blamed himself for the lack of any production. Thought I was just bored to tears. But when he began to comfort me and ask why I was crying, I told him honestly that it was our last day at Stramond, and I really didn't want to leave. It was a privilege just to sit in that boat with him all afternoon and spend time with my granddad. And years ago, I was genuinely upset that the moment had to end, but it wasn't because the fishing was over or anything like that. Rather, I was overwhelmed by how special it was that we had the privilege to spend that time together in the first place. And even though we may never understand why a good man like Granddad is taken away, we have faith that he is now able to rest, as described in our passage from Isaiah 73. So just as I think back to that moment in Lake Stramond, even as we mourn his loss, I know Bob would still want us to focus on and cherish those special moments we have and the privilege that we receive in spending this time together. So with that, thank you again for coming here today.
And now I invite Bob's son, Rob, to come forward and share with us.
Good afternoon, and thank you all so much for being here today. In thinking about Dad and his 80 years on this earth, many things come to mind, but one theme across all of those decades for us who lived it with him, it was never boring. Woven through all the places Dad was and the people that my father encountered, what is a common thread is that he enjoyed the company of others, had a good time with them, and loved to find a way to laugh, including at himself. Going all the way back to his days at Princeton, there are so many enjoyable stories that I heard about, especially the Cannon Club stories, where he and Mom spent plenty of time. But the fun at Princeton did not end upon graduation. Dad loved nothing more than going back to his class of 66 reunions, and in our younger years, taking the entire family there, getting all dressed up in the class garb, which entailed blue pinstripe engineer overalls and orange t-shirts underneath, and spending the weekend under the tent watching all of Mom and Dad's friends get together as if it was still the mid-1960s. The same can be said about him going back to Nashville to reunions at Vanderbilt. With several of his friends living in Nashville after law school, Dad loved to go down there and do some recruiting for the law firm and be able to spend time seeing classmates in the process with a fun time, the norm for their get-togethers. I saw firsthand how much he and his classmates enjoyed getting together during my very first college visit ever to Vanderbilt, to the point where I knew then and there that this was the school I wanted to attend. Those friendships at both schools have endured for all of these years. But these lifelong friendships went beyond school. When Mom and Dad moved to Pittsburgh right after law school, they established themselves quickly here in Sewickley. My father was fortunate to have Mom, who likely was the catalyst to meeting so many people here. But once they made good friends, Dad was fiercely loyal to them, and those relationships remained forever, turning into things like the weekend tennis buddies that he had. Speaking of tennis, I could not let a remembrance of my father take place without a mention of the tennis court, as that became such a focus of activity from late spring into the fall every single year. Dad so enjoyed the Saturday and Sunday morning tennis at the house. It was his weekend bonding session with so many of his close friends over the years. And oh my goodness, they had tremendous fun together playing tennis with relentless needling, chirping, harassing, and the winners gloating during and after the match. It was all good-natured and fun, but I have to tell you, at the end of every summer, Jake, Thomas, and Ben Mulholland had developed a much broader, mature vocabulary skill set. Over the years, there were numerous other events he loved to be part of, ranging from the father-son fishing trips up to Quebec, which a tradition which lasted long enough, as you heard from RY, to turn into the grandfather-father-son fishing trips. So many summers were spent with friends up at Rocky Point Inn in the Adirondack Mountains, and not just with the Elsties, Wells, and Squires, but the many friends we met up there every year. It did not stop there as they developed deep-rooted friendships with the Longs and the Cousins, Sally and Watts, and so many others who we as kids all grew up spending holidays and special occasions together. Dad and Mom loved more than anything to host all these friends out in Sun Valley, Idaho during all four seasons of the year. Whether it was fly fishing, skiing, going out to dinner, maybe a round of golf, or Dad's favorite, the game of horseshoes across the river with a cocktail in hand with the McCanns or the Berries. So how does all this tie together? I spent several minutes trying to describe so many things, but perhaps it's better said in his own words. This excerpt is from his 25th Princeton reunion notebook. And I'm quoting now. As dull as it sounds, I can say without flinching that my focus is on family and friends. I have a great wife who has tolerated me for a quarter of a century. Three neat kids with solid values and friends for whom I'd kill. At Princeton, the outdoors meant little to me. Now, increasingly, my free time is spent in Idaho, where the outdoor recreation recharges my batteries. As his family grew in size, Dad began to spend more time with his four grandsons. His passion for playing sports turned into watching his grandsons play sports, and he could be seen watching hockey games or tennis matches. He would watch Max skate up the ice or Silas hit a tennis ball, and the response was really quite predictable. He's going to be incredible, as if we were watching the next Sidney Crosby or Novak Djokovic. He loved teaching RY and Jared how to play chess. And in no time, they got really good at it, and the matches were often over in very short order. But Dad forever remained competitive and tried to win. He loved to engage the two of them on more serious topics like history, books, even politics as they grew older, and those conversations were never dull. Dad always remained a child at heart, though, and he loved mischievous, silly fun. Sure, he loved to take Max out and try to teach him how to throw a fly into the river behind the house in Idaho, but the sheer silliness of Dad putting Max into his little black car out in Idaho when he was about 2 or 3 years old, pulling him up to the top of the gently sloped driveway and then gently pushing him from behind, watching the car drift and spin down the asphalt. And ultimately, that was never good enough. As these sessions continued, undoubtedly what would happen is the pushes turned more into really hard shoves, going down the driveway much harder, and instead of coming to rest in the driveway, there'd be a massive collision with the garage door, and both of them laughing hysterically at what just took place. But as the older grandkids graduated from college and got jobs, or the younger ones started school, Dad always took pride in the grades they all got, often questioning whether or not this child really was a Kopf with a report card that looks this good. In closing, I'd like to share two stories about Dad's last 24 hours. He made it clear to us that he knew that it was time to go, and he seemed at peace with that. As he would drift off to sleep, we felt like he believed this was the time, and that he would awaken seeing God and seeing Mom, and then maybe 20 minutes later, he'd wake up, and there would be Maggie and me sitting at the base of the bed in the chairs. And after a short pause, when his eyes would open, the only words that came out were, "Oh, God." Such a disappointment to see it, the two of us sitting there. As you all know, Dad died on Good Friday in the wee hours of the morning, so I could not help but think about the meaning of Easter weekend with him joining Mom during that time. After he passed away, Maggie and I chuckled together over the thought of Dad rejoining his dear wife, set in her ways, wife, after these 26 months in between. Clearly, they were both delighted to be reunited, but we wondered how long it took Dad to do something to annoy Mom. I put the over-under at about 20 to 30 minutes. So we sit here today remembering a business person who loved what he did, a father and grandfather and a friend, but all in all, a great person, grounded in principles and ethics, someone who loved to laugh with family and friends, and did so often at his own expense. Dad, we are going to miss your laugh, your guidance, and your wisdom, but you taught us all things important at such an early age that we should have all that figured out by now. All of us here today are pleased about a few other things near and dear to you. We were pleased on the day of your passing, the Battlers won their opening day game and were in first place, and the Pens were making an unexpected, improbable push to make the playoffs. But most of all, we are happy that you have met Mom once again and can live out eternity with her. Just don't forget to brush, water, and roll the tennis court up there so it's ready for all of us later.
And now I invite Bob's brother Silas to come forward and share with us his thoughts as well.
Big brother, anyone with a big brother or an older sibling realizes the special nature of that relationship. They become the ones to look up to and the ones to follow. And that was my relationship with Bob. He showed the path all through my childhood, although we had a 6-year age difference. And so that was a lot when you're a kid. And even though he was bigger, stronger, could run faster and so on, he invited me to play games with him. I'd get the football and I think he set it up so that I could run for the touchdown. So I knew that moment of triumph. And that was Bob's way. He wanted people to be winners. And I was happy that he treated me that way, at least until we were the same size. And then that competitive edge took a different thing, but more on that later. Bob went away to boarding school, and I was just 9 years old. And he didn't hold the same prominence for me because he was away half the year. But he was still the example. He went on to Princeton, and that became the shiny object for me to try and grab for. That his goals then became my goals. And I need to interject here something about the older brother. It must have been about 25 years ago that I was visiting here in Sewickley. There was a party. Bob and I were standing around with cocktail in hand, just chatting, and a woman named Barb came up to us. And she said, "Oh, Bob, you must introduce me to your older brother." And Bob just roared at that. He loved that so much. And for the next 25 years, I became older brother. And that's the way it should be, because I am more mature, clearly. So that was a fun stop with him, a recurring thing. For my 60th birthday, I invited Bob to my party in Massachusetts, where I live. I had rented a hall big enough to have a good-sized party. We had about 100 people come, and we were going to have sumo wrestling. I rented these big, giant sumo suits, and we had preliminary matches with my friends. Everybody got a big kick out of that, but the main event was going to be me fighting Bob. So we disappeared into an outer room to get the suits on, and they are literally like this. We waddled out onto the mat. I had an MC who had the microphone and said, he announced Bob's name, and all of my friends then booed. They treated him like he was the Iron Sheik, and then I got introduced like I was Hulk Hogan. It was evil against good. And of course, you probably want to know what happened. I paid him back for all of those years of picking on me. So I have a favorite in telling story about Bob from decades ago. Every winter, the family would go to Florida for about a month. Bob couldn't come when he was in school, but he would come down for spring break. And the thing that my mother loved to do down there in Florida was to get the Sunday newspaper, the Sunday New York Times, and sit outside in a beach chair and read the paper all day long. But there was no Sunday paper delivery in the neighborhood, so somebody had to go downtown and get it. That became Bob's job because he had the driver's license. So he was sent off, came back about 20 minutes later, and he was supposed to have the New York Times and the Miami Herald. He had the Miami Herald and the Philadelphia Inquirer. And Mom said, "Bob, where's the Times?" And Bob looked at her and said, "The Times was 75 cents, the Inquirer was 35 cents. The Times is a big ripoff." And I am confident that to his dying day, he never once bought a New York Times. And I'm also pretty confident that he never once read one. At some point, I was here in Sewickley visiting. I used to enjoy coming here. And I had a pretty wild and unusual suit that I thought I was going to introduce to Bob. Knowing his conservative nature, I didn't know how he was going to take it, but the time came, we were going to go out to dinner, and I went upstairs to change into my suit, my unusual suit. I came downstairs, and I heard Bob say, "Good grief, you can't wear that to the Allegheny Country Club. You look like a circus clown." Okay, I'll go change. And then Sue stood up and said, no, Bob, this will be fun. Let's go ahead and do this. So I did go to the dinner in my clown suit. And I think it was well received. And Bob thought, okay, well, that's pretty cool. But on future visits, I'd always have a conversation with Bob before I'd come. And he would sort of slyly say, "Well, what are you going to wear?" And so at some point, I came here. He had invited me to talk to his Smithfield clients. And again, he didn't specifically ask me to wear something special, but I know deep down he really wanted me to wear something special. So I did. I spoke to his Smithfield people in my Hawaiian print suit. But the kicker was that immediately after the talk, there was a Penguins playoff game. and he desperately wanted to go to the Penguins game. And he wanted to take me, that was good, but there was no time to change. I had to go to the Penguins game dressed in my clown suit. And he said, "You can't go to a Penguins game looking like that. Somebody's going to beat you up." And I said, "Well, come on, Bob. No option here. I want to see the game, too." So off we went to the game, parked the car, are walking into the arena, and there was an attendant there, and he looked me up and down. He said, "Yo, dude, love your threads, man." So I thought, okay, this is a good sign. This is going to go okay here. So we got into the arena. All the people before the game were milling around in the public area there. And these two young women came up to me, and they were sort of cooed, "Could we take a selfie with you?" So put my arms around them, and Bob slowly went to the side, shaking his head. And I swear I heard him say, "I can't believe it." So this memorial is a solemn goodbye to you, Bob. You're surrounded by family, friends. It would have felt totally irreverent to wear a clown suit at this event. This is my all-purpose charcoal wedding and funeral suit. But, you know, hey, what the hell? There, now I feel more comfortable. Bob, I hope you're more comfortable with my presence here at this event, too. But I want to close by saying what I thought was Bob's most admirable trait. He was totally committed to family. And he obviously dearly loved Suze. He was the biggest cheerleader of his children and grandchildren. He even gave his brothers the support that they probably didn't deserve. So, Bob, you're going to be particularly missed by family, but given the number of people here at this service, you have touched many, many others as well.
And now I invite you all to stand and join us as we sing together hymn number 840 in the hymnals, "It Is Well With My Soul."
Thank you.
You may be seated. And now for our first scripture reading. It comes from the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. Hear now the word of the Lord. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. This ends the reading. Now I invite you to stand and join me for our unison scripture reading that comes from Psalm chapter 23. It's printed on the back of your bulletins for you to follow along. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated. And now I invite Ms. Rosie Reitz to join us and lead us in our anthem, Let It Be.
When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. In my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. And when the broken heart, people living in the world agree, there will be an answer, let it be. For though they may be parted, there is still a chance that they will see. There will be an answer, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be. There will be an answer, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. Cloudy, there is still a light that shines on me. Shine until tomorrow, let it be. I wake up to the sound of music. Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. There will be an answer. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Speaking words of wisdom, let it be.
Our second scripture lesson today comes from the book of 1 Corinthians. We'll be reading the second half of 1 Corinthians 13, which is famously known as the love chapter. We'll be reading from verses 8 to 13. But before we go to God's word, let's first go to God in prayer. Let us pray. O Lord, as we turn our attention now to your word on this day, a day filled with memory, with thanksgiving, and with sorrow, we ask that your Spirit would be with us. And the Spirit who inspired the writing of these words would inspire our hearing. We ask that you would show us who you are. You would show us your love for Bob. You would show us who you have created us to be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, beginning at verse 8. Listen to the word of God. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. And as for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part. Then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide, these three. And the greatest of these is love. Here ends the reading. Let us pray. Lord, as we reflect now on your word, we ask that you would be with us. We ask that you would give us the stories to share, the tears to cry, the friends for comfort. We ask that you would bless us as we give thanks for Bob and claim the promise of your love for him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we gather in moments like this, it is one of the incredible privileges of ministry to get to know people from a different angle and to get to hear the greatest memories, the most cherished stories of the saints of the church. And as you all have shared your stories with us this morning, and as you shared your memories with me previously, as we read scripture together, there's something that recurred several times. Maybe you all noticed it as well. And it's something that I think comes to us from another passage of scripture. It comes to us from one of Paul's letters to the church of the Thessalonian Christians. He writes at the end of his letter these words from 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 9 to 11. As he's preparing to close his letter, Paul says, "For God has destined us, not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing." As Paul writes this letter, he writes to these Thessalonian Christians, these friends of his, and he concludes with this compliment and this challenge. He tells them to encourage one another and build up one another as they were doing. That's a hard thing to do. We throw the word encouragement around a lot. But to encourage someone, to really encourage someone, it's really hard. To encourage someone truly, it means you have to take the time to get to know them. You have to take the time to know who they are, to know who they really are, to know their strengths, to know their weaknesses, to know their loves. And not only do you need to know who they are, you need to know who they can become. You have to be able to see not just who they are at the moment, but the best possibilities for them. The potential they may not even see in themselves. That's the story that you shared with us today. Three generations, brother, son, grandson. You told us stories of Bob seeing who you really are, of taking the time to play tennis, to go fishing, to sumo wrestle. You told the stories of Bob taking time to spend with you. We read from Ecclesiastes, there's a time to build up, and Bob took time to build up. He saw the time to build up was any time he was with you. This is why he went out of his way to attend the parties and performances and plays and games and graduations. He wanted to know you for who you really are. And he would say things like, he's going to be incredible. He saw not only who you are, but who you can be. But that's not enough to be encouraging. That's observation. That's daydreaming. That's analysis. To be encouraging, to build up, it takes action. It means not just seeing, but counting the cost and calculating the risk and giving the people around us courage to take it. And this is who Bob was. He did this in his own life. This is what caused him in his career to take a step back and look at who he was, to see who he could become, and to create his own company. This is who he was, driving himself to learn, his voracious appetite for reading history and biography, to read anything he could get his hands on, to encourage others to do the same, to review the books that he liked, to contact the authors that he loved, and to build them up and draw the best out of them. He was someone driven to build up, to take the time to build up. And this is part of what we saw in all the stories you shared with us about that competitive edge. His almost stubborn refusal to let the kids win. This notion that it was more important to learn how to do things well, to drive, to do better, to develop, to improve. His encouragement, it had an edge at times, such as that which led to the expansion of vocabularies in those tennis games. His encouragement had an edge, but it was an edge that was good-natured. It was an edge that drove everyone around him to become not who they were, but who they could be. To take the calculated risk, to take that counted cost, to step into a new future, to build up, to inspire, to encourage, to improve, to bring the best out of all of you, and especially out of you. His love was a love that saw time to build up, and he took the time to build up. He took the time to encourage. And as Paul closes this letter, he gives his friends this great compliment. He tells them that they have already been building and encouraging one another, but he gives them this challenge. They've seen what it looks like to build up and to encourage, and so he challenges them to do the same. He challenges them to grow and to improve and to increase by learning how to build up and how to encourage. Bob spent so much time. He took the time to build you, but mostly to build you. Learn from Bob to take time to build. Take time to encourage. See the people around you for who they are. See who they can become. And help them grow into the people God has made them to be. As we spend these moments together, we've heard about Bob's life. We've heard the impact he has had on each of us. And we go back to the beginning of these verses from Paul. He wrote that God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us. Bob was a longtime faithful member of this church. He asked questions about faith in his last days. And we are here to proclaim the promises made at Bob's baptism, that God loves us no matter what. God chose Bob. God saves Bob. God is with Bob even now. As we gather today, we proclaim the promise of God's love for Bob. We build one another up. We encourage one another. And we seek to follow his example, to take time to build the people we love. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. In moments like this, as we wrestle with our sorrow, there are few words as powerful as those of the hymn Amazing Grace. And so I invite you to stand with me as we sing together hymn number 649, Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Now, as we transition into a time of prayer, I'm going to begin with some words of prayer and lead us, and we will transition into together saying the Lord's Prayer. I recognize that many of us come from different backgrounds, traditions, and we may use some slightly different language as we pray the Lord's Prayer. That is just fine. We will leave space and time. If you want to say debts, you can join us in saying debts. If you say trespasses or sins, God will hear our prayers nonetheless. And so let us now go to God in prayer. Let us pray. O God, before whom generations rise and pass away, we praise you for all your servants who have, having lived this life in faith, now live eternally with you. And especially today, we thank you for your servant Bob, whose baptism is now complete in death. We praise you for the gift of his life, for all in him that was good and kind and faithful, for the grace you gave him that kindled in him the love of your dear name and enabled him to serve you faithfully. Lord God, we thank you so much for Bob's love, for his wit, for his thirst for knowledge, his curiosity, his embrace of peace and solitude in the outdoors, for his humor, for the way that he inhabited space with his friends and his family. And Lord, we thank you that for him death is past and pain is ended, that he has now entered the joy you have prepared. And now we ask that you be with Bob, and that you be with all of us with confidence, praying the words that your son Jesus taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Will you all please rise and join me in the words of commendation that are in your bulletin? Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Bob. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive your child into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of saints in light.
As we conclude our service, I will give you the benediction in just a moment, and then Mike and I will lead the family out into the Robinson room. And as a reminder, they invite you, once they've had the chance to exit, we invite you to exit the sanctuary and to join them at the address which you will find printed on the bottom of your bulletin. But as we prepare to go from this place, I charge you to remember Bob and his legacy. Remember Susie and the joy that she chose. Remember the joy that is theirs as they are reunited. Remember the ways that Bob took time to build up the people around him, to build up the community around him, to encourage the people closest to him. Remember the ways Bob took time to build you into the people you are today. I charge you to tell those stories to each other. Tell the funny stories and laugh at them. Tell the sad stories and cry about them. But above all, I charge you to build up. Take time to get to know the people God has placed in your life. Learn who they truly are. Learn who they can truly become. And encourage them to grow. Encourage them to develop. Encourage them to become the people they can be. Encourage one another and build one another up. And as you go from this place, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, now and forever. Amen.